In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, Amen. Glory be to Jesus Christ.
Glory
forever. Glory forever. Meaningfully, this is the second of the great feasts. The first one, which we observed last week, is in a way symbolically the birth of the church. It is taking us with Mary on a spiritual journey. The second feast tells us right away, lest we forget, that the cross is the gospel, that Christianity is in the cross, and that we may desire to preach some other gospel, live some other faith, go through some other path, but no, it is about the cross of Jesus Christ, and at times our own. But this feast has also an historical significance, which I think we as Orthodox need to know and understand and even embrace. Historically, we remember that the mother of the Emperor Constantine, Helen, yes, John, be quiet while you leave. That at the end of her life, the Queen Mother, to use that in fact biblical term, wanted to go on a personal pilgrimage to the holy places to really, in a way, fulfill and openly live her Christian faith. And so she went to Jerusalem, and after a long story, which is kept in the archives of the city, and which you can read in many ancient records, she discovered the true cross. Now, let me say, you know, why desire to find the true cross? And I think the answer is that the Christian faith is really an historical faith. It's rooted in one person, on one mountain, on one cross. It's not an abstract idea. In some ways, when we think about, say, Hinduism, it's not about so much people, it's really about ideas, about philosophies. But Christianity is subsumed in a person and in an event. And so the creed, every liturgy, every Sunday, every baptism mentions Pontius Pilate. It's about a particular event, and this feast remembers, in fact, history. Now, beyond this recovery of the precious and life-giving cross by Empress Helen, the Queen Mother, there is the fact, as you can expect, that this precious relic was lost. It was lost in the 600s, at a time when tribes and armies from the east were beginning to enter and conquer and rule over historically Christian lands. And that is, I think, an historical event that resonates to this very day. This very day, we can plug into these events of the 6th and 7th and 800s and actually find much food for thought. At that time, the Emperor Heraclius set on a quest to recover the city of Jerusalem and with it the cross which had been lost. And eventually he did. He did. And perhaps you want to read in various sources about the life of this Emperor Heraclius. It's really quite fascinating. As we were looking at methods to teach children, one particular school of thought, which I think we can all agree, is that if you give people dates and names, they'll forget. But if you make them read stories, and ideally kind of living stories about these people, they'll remember, they'll connect with them as real people, going through real life as they are. You can read that online in the Britannica encyclopedia. You can read this little blurb about this Emperor Heraclius. And I think it's interesting to read what they have to say. It says, the Byzantines, well, the Romans, it's under this emperor that for the first time you could argue that you could start calling them Byzantine because they began to speak Greek. Under this Emperor Heraclius, Latin was discontinued as the official language. Wow. And they began to actually speak only Greek as the official language of the empire. So the Roman Empire, which then becomes Byzantine, they were defeated in a great battle on the Yarmouk in the year 636. Soon, Syria and Egypt fell to the Arabs. Not sure that's the right term. There wasn't really a term at the time. Maybe the Saracens, right? The Ishmaelites sometimes. Different ways to say what happened. Then it says this, Heraclius returned northward, bearing the holy wood. Once the object of his greatest glory, now the companion of his deepest soul. I think it's a tremendous summary of our life with the cross. At times, the object of our great glory and joy, and sometimes the companion of our deepest soul, as was true for him. So I think that this feast being biblical and historical is a good thing because we need history. More and more, I think in our culture, people don't really care about history so much. There's the news of the day, which often is significant for less than 24 hours, maybe a week. History teaches us a lot more. We really need it. There's a saying that those who would ignore history are doomed to repeat it. And sometimes you speak to the younger generation and you talk about history, and I mean recent history, the Nazi era, the concentration camps, the gulags, the Soviets, and it's just no longer relevant. When really it should teach us, it must. Or else terrible things may simply occur again because we have lost the lessons of history. In some ways, the gospel tonight is the fulfillment of history gone wrong. If you think about the Old Testament, which is really the heart, right, the heart of the scriptures in many ways, the history of God's people were told, God is your king. And we proclaim this over and over in our liturgies. God is our king. And they said at some point, well, thanks, but no thanks. We'd like to have a king we can see to be like everybody else. So they got a king. And that didn't go very well. There was King Saul, then there was King David, there was King Solomon, then there was the split. Eventually they were so corrupt that they were destroyed and sent into exile. They came back but never really had a king. And they were ruled by these not really legitimate high priests. Then they were ruled by these corrupt kings like King Herod, who was really a puppet of Caesar. And then, at the very end of their demise, of their journey into the abyss of darkness, they say, we have no king but Caesar. The complete undoing of every lesson of history. How sad. So the cross is really, I think, a beckoning for us to think historically. To not just live for the moment, but to really think big. I think the Holy Spirit does that. It makes us look at eternity, the past and the future, in the mind of God. So a few practical things. Number one, we cannot empty the cross of its power, which is what St. Paul warns us not to do. In 1 Corinthians 1:17, we cannot empty the cross of its power. It's possible to design the cross 20 times a day and have no sense of the power of the cross. Secondly, we need to force ourselves, because we see the cross all the time, to meditate on the message of the cross. And what is that message? Oh, well, that could be a long. So, briefly, among the things I would say is that the greatest evil, the greatest suffering, the greatest injustice turns out to be by the power of God, the greatest good. I think that works for us sometimes when we are suffering. When our child is dying of cancer, we need the message of the cross. When our loved one's mother, father, brother is dying of a terrible disease or simply dying of old age, we need to believe in the power of the message of the cross. That in that suffering, there can be glory and redemption and tremendous good. Lest, of course, we let these things go in vain. It's possible for the cross of Jesus Christ to be in vain for us. And that's a terrible thought. That great offering of the high priest on the cross for the sin of the whole world could be of no avail to us. St. Paul says in Galatians that for you Christ could be of no avail. And that is a terrifying thought. For that suffering to be of no avail for us, and for our own sufferings to just have no meaning. To not be a cross of Christ, but simply just a terrible inconvenience for which we point the fist at God. The way some people who cursed the cross, like Stalin, died, their fist at God, cursing their suffering and never embracing the message of the cross. And then finally, I think the cross, that is very symbol, is the intersection of time and eternity. Christ says, I am the way, I am the life, I am the resurrection. He can say, this is my body and my blood, even before he's crucified. In the divine, there's a perfect harmony, unity between the being and the acting. And the cross shows that God is love, and there is the act, the cross. We must be like that. There must be perfect unity in us Christians before our being in Christ and our acting. And that, I think, is the curse of the fall. With Adam and Eve, suddenly it all became project. If you eat, you will get those things. Life became kind of a project with maybes and our own will, our own plans and schemes and distant horizons. And that wasn't meant to be like that. We're meant to actualize who we are in Christ, in God, and in all that we do. The tree is meant to be the fruits, and the fruits are meant to be the tree. This whole discussion about faith and works is a denial of being in Christ, in whom we must act holiness by the power of the cross. To him who saves us, who will save us in history, who makes us wise by the power of the cross and the glory, our Lord Jesus Christ, with God the Father, in heaven, and the Holy Spirit, now and ever, unto ages and ages. Amen. Glory be to Jesus Christ. Glory be to God.
Let us sing with our full soul. our fathers, we pray thee, hear us and have mercy.
Have mercy
on us, O God, according to thy great goodness, we pray thee, hear us and have mercy. For all our priests and deacons, and for all our family in Christ.
Lord, have mercy.
Again, we pray for this country's president, for all civil authorities, and for the armed forces everywhere.
Lord, have mercy.
Again, we pray for the blessed and ever memorable Holy Orthodox Patriarchs, and for the blessed and ever-memorable founders of this holy house, for all our fathers, mothers, and relatives, the right-believing Christians, to their rest before us here, and throughout the world, lie asleep in the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Again, we pray for mercy, life, peace, healing, salvation, visitation, for the servants of God, the priest, and the Matushka Mary.